What can stand against the Lord, and what is too big for God? The answer is absolutely nothing. Hello, Gifted family. We love you, and we all appreciate you for staying with us. May God give us a testimony this month in Jesus. Let's get into the Word with Pastor Kwame. Thank you, and my name is Stephanie.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear His voice. Amen. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus, the Son, and give Him glory for the great things He's done. Amen. Spirit of the living God, we pray that You will lead us into this class. I ask that as I begin to open up, You will speak, and let everything I say be that which You have ordained it to be. I pray that You will come and kind of teach us Your will. I also pray for those who are still trying to hold up and hold themselves up in the middle of this challenge that the whole world is going through. And I pray for those who need You to open up a door for them, that You will open a door and no one can shut. We honor Your name, Jesus. We come to humble ourselves before You, that You will teach us Your will. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Child of God, how are you? So, we're going to talk about five keys to intimacy with Jesus. And for those of you that will join the Gifted Church, the Cyber Gifted Church, you are going to experience these kinds of teachings. The podcast is really not a teaching ministry. It's more of inspiration. It's more of encouragement. So you don't get to receive the full counsel of God. But when it comes to the teaching ministry, it's more systematically done. It is based on what I call exposition. That means it is verse by verse teaching, and that is where you get to grasp the full mind of God. So again, this is a supplement. You cannot grow spiritually if the podcast is the only thing that you listen to, because the podcast is not the full scope of what God has instructed the believer to depend on. And so today is going to be more Bible class, so to speak. I want to begin by challenging you to understand that we came to this place because I started talking about intimacy with Jesus Christ being the basis, or intimacy with Jesus Christ being the starting point of everything that Christianity will add to your life. In other words, if you're not intimate with Christ, you are not a Christian. You understand that. You can call yourself one, you can fellowship with one, but if you're not intimate with Christ, you are not a Christian, because you will not change into His image. You will not receive the portion that is due you. You will not process like this. So long as the owner of the house is a baby, he is no different from a slave. So that when you are not intimate with Christ and you are not growing in Christ, then the things that Christ has done for you, you won't benefit. You can't experience it. So your life will be just like the girl next door. Your life will be just like the man next door, because nothing is happening to you based on the fact that you call the name of Christ. Amen. So there is a little bit of significant awareness that I was bringing, and that gave birth to the class we're going to teach today. I'm still going to stick with time and not go too much past the usual time, hopefully 18 to 25 to 26 minutes. Praise God. Amen. So I think I will do the verse, and then we will come back to talk about the five things. And it's exactly from where we are looking at. So in the book of Philippians, we encounter Paul's measure of intimacy with Christ. He pins down a lot of things, and I pick five of them to just draw our attention to it. When Paul says, I am intimate with Christ, he means it in a way. So in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, Paul says, I want to know Christ. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised Him from the dead. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised Him. In this class that I'm going to teach, the five keys to intimacy with Jesus Christ, I'm going to take all the five keys from the book of Philippians chapter 3. And because it's more like Pauline's explanation. Now that I've said the verse, let's talk. If you're a Christian, either casually or intimately, the bottom line is this. You probably have heard that to grow in Christ, you need to read your Bible and pray every day. Unfortunately, that is not true. The Bible doesn't even say that. Reading your Bible and praying every day will not make you grow in Christ. I'm sorry to disappoint you, but the Bible never says that. Reading your Bible and praying every day will not get you to be a Christian. Because what ends up happening is this: you will just, if you don't understand a particular verse, you will read that verse for 10 years, you still will not understand it, right? If you want to pray every day, you will pray every day and you will never grow, because that is not really how you grow. If you look at even what the Bible says in Ephesians that for a Christian to grow, they must be touched in five ways. He says, I gave them apostles, teachers, prophets, evangelists, pastors, so that they can grow. So even when you talk about spiritual growth or being intimate with Christ or growing in Christ, you can't do anything. You have to kind of receive in a way to grow. It's not what you give, it's what you receive that makes you grow, right? So it is very significant that you understand that reading your Bible and praying is a good thing, but you can't grow that way. Because repetition makes you permanent and not perfect. You understand? So remember in the scripture, the Bible says that the Ethiopian was asked by Philip, do you understand what you're reading? He said, how can I understand it unless somebody explains to me? So in growing in Christ, you can really grow if you read your Bible every day and you pray. That's not how you get intimate with Christ. Not at all. So we're going to go to the five keys to intimacy with Christ. And so, because not everybody doesn't challenge it, but we all know that some people who have been reading the Bible every day and praying, they are still the same. So that's pretty much, that's not how you grow. God has made it such a way that you need to be taught, you need to be discipled to grow. You know, there's no independent study in the things of God. You have to be discipled to grow. So I just want to start with that. Now we're going to go through the five keys to intimacy with Jesus Christ. The five keys to intimacy. And like I said, they are all found in the book of Philippians chapter 3. And so we have to, because of time, I have to just hit it and go and just emphasize on it. But to be intimate with Christ, the reason I said that is not how long you pray, which you find out that it's not how long you pray, it's not how deep you are with God, and it's not how kind of sensitive you are when you close your eyes and you are in deep thought with God. It's not about how many hours you pray in a day. It's not about that at all. Understand? So intimacy with Christ has little to do with a religious activity. You understand? Intimacy with Christ has little to do with closing your eyes in worship and tearing up and crying. That is not intimacy with Christ. But I think the charismatic movement has kind of pushed that to be intimacy with Christ. When you can pray for 6 hours, it means what? Intimacy with Christ. Intimacy with Christ is not spending, it is part of it, but that is not really what we are going to focus on. Not like deeply in love with Christ, the point that you are crying and you are very emotional and you are very much prayerful, and that is not intimacy with Christ. All right. So what is intimacy with Christ? And so in the five keys to intimacy with Christ, Paul begins by saying, from the first point, he says that a good attitude towards Jesus Christ is the beginning of intimacy with Christ. And Paul describes in Philippians chapter 3, verse 1, he says, now a good attitude of joy is a necessity in Christ. So understand that intimacy in Christ has to do with the way you do your life, not the way you pray. The way you live your life. It's not the way you pray that makes you intimate. What you do after you finish praying is the beginning of your intimacy with Christ. If you are intimate with Christ, we will know after you finish praying. If you are intimate with Christ, we will know after you finish worshiping. If you are intimate with Christ, we will know after. You understand that? So when Paul is talking about that I may know him, he centers knowing him, not with knowing him like I want to pray more so I can know him. He says when you know Christ, there is an evidence of your knowledge of Christ. And that's what I want to focus on, so that when you are pursuing the knowledge of Christ, you will not get caught up in religious activity, thinking that if I read my Bible very long, it means I'm in intimacy with Christ. Not at all. You know a lot of people that are very intimate with Christ, but they are horrible people. You understand that, right? So you understand that that's not what the scripture is saying. So let me go in and talk to you about it. Now, before I say that, let me just practically say that when you're talking about intimacy in marriage, most people think intimacy in marriage is sex. You understand? Therefore, if intimacy in marriage is sex, then worship is also intimacy with Christ, right? That is what we have taught people, that intimacy in marriage is equal to sex, right? And therefore, if I'm talking about intimacy with Christ, it's about how I worship him, how I fall down, how I cry when I sing, you know, because I'm very intimate, I'm very close to him. But not at all. Intimacy in marriage is not sex. Intimacy in marriage is the ability to connect to your wife and your partner on every level. Do you understand that? If the only thing you do with your wife is sex, you are not intimate with your wife. You have to be intimate mentally, intimate psychologically, intimate in every area. That means you are intimate with your partner. Because sex is not intimate for men at all. Sex is, when it comes to men, sex is not an intimate act. That's why a man can walk up to a prostitute and sleep with a prostitute, because for men, sex is not an intimate part. So intimacy in a couple is a hard thing. It's how the two of you are in sync together in every level. That's what we call intimacy. So that's the same thing. So worship might be a very romantic thing that you do with God, but that doesn't mean anything when it comes to intimacy with Christ. You understand? To intimacy with Christ, it has different angles. The first one you talk about is that intimacy with Jesus Christ has to do with your attitude towards Jesus. Your attitude towards Jesus. What he says that now, Paul emphatically says that in everything you have to be joyful. He says you have to be joyful. Philippians chapter 3 verse 1. That's the first key if you're going to be intimate with Christ. When it comes to the things of Christ, your attitude has to be full of joy. In other words, when it comes to Christ, be joyful in the Lord, because it safeguards your faith. So joy is a key of intimacy. And I think it's also the same way when it comes to every marriage. Anybody who's in a marriage where the attitude is right, anytime you are with a person, you exemplify the attitude of joy. When you do that, you are demonstrating the fact that, yes, indeed, this person is in love with me. So when it comes to things of God, when it comes to everything about God, you have to keep the attitude of joy. If you can do that, and practically it means that you serve God with joy, you go to church with joy, you give with joy, everything about God, you do it with joy. That means that you are trying to abide and intimately relate to God. The first thing is that anything you do for God, with God, by God, it must have the attitude of joy. Some people, the way they serve God, you know that they don't love this God. It's like compulsory. It's out of guilt. It's out of a sense of, I have to do it for somebody. If you don't love the guy, don't marry him. And so intimacy with Jesus Christ begins with the attitude. So write that down. Philippians chapter 3 verse 1 is the first point. The key to intimacy with Christ, number one, is a good attitude towards Christ. And that good attitude is defined as the attitude of joy. You must do this thing with Jesus Christ with joy. Amen. It's very important. The second thing that Paul says now is that the second key to intimacy with Christ is a good knowledge of who Jesus is, and especially the work of Jesus Christ. And that one is Philippians 3 verse 3. It says now, we have to know the finished work he has done. So when it comes to knowing Jesus, it's not by knowing his mother's name. It's not about knowing like the Sunday school knowledge of Jesus Christ, right? That's not what intimacy with him is about. In the same way, like, for example, if I say you know your partner or you know your husband, it's not about knowing his shoe size and all of that. No, you have to know who he is and what he's about. So when it comes to Jesus Christ, the second key to intimacy is to understand who Jesus is. And that has to do with the knowledge about who Jesus is. And that has to do with the finished work he has done. You have to invest in understanding what it means by Jesus Christ have justified me. So one of the things that we don't know a lot in this charismatic movement is the knowledge of doctrines and theology. We don't know at all. Our grip on the finished work of Christ is very loose. That's why we have so many strange things happening in the church. Any occult, any fetish priest, anybody can deceive the church today because we lack knowledge. But Paul says that intimacy with Christ requires good knowledge about who Jesus is. What does Jesus mean? What does Jesus mean? What does he mean? Because Jesus is a verb. Jesus is a noun. Jesus is a pronoun. You have to be able to put him in the right place. So when it comes to an example in real life, it's more like asking, how might I put it? Asking something like, do you really know your husband? What he's about? What is his purpose? The purpose of Jesus Christ is the beginning of intimacy with him. That's what Paul will understand and understand that, because to know Jesus Christ, you have to rest on his finished work. And you have to understand what work has he done. And the work Jesus has done is not what you think. It's not the healing he brought. It's not the deliverance he brought. It's not the things he brought. But the finished work on the cross, what it means for you to be able to stand right with Christ. So you have to invest in that knowledge. You understand that? And that is the beginning of intimacy with him. Amen. And the third thing is your values must come from him. Your values and your value must come from Christ. I know this is very theological, but it is meat for your soul. And I'm going to give you a practical example for each point so you understand what I'm saying. So if you are intimate with Christ, it means that your values and your value come from him. That is verse 8 of chapter 3. Paul says that everything I have, I count it as nothing so that I will know this Christ. So that means that when it comes to you understanding that you are intimate with Christ, your pursuit is to find your value in Christ. Your value is not in your beauty. Your value is not in your academics. You don't, and it's a hard thing. If your value is not in Christ, you are not intimate with Christ. What are you willing to forget about to be in Christ? Do you understand that? Because everybody knows what they value. But if Paul says now, when it comes to me in Christ, my degree, my tribe, whatever that people value as important, when it comes to Christ, I don't value any of that. My only value is I'm a Christian. You understand that? He says, when I understood who Christ is, I threw all my Judaistic concept away. I threw all that. So when it comes to your value in Christ, you are not valuable because of the family you come from. You are not valuable because you are in America. You are not valuable because you are beautiful. You are not valuable because you have finished college. That is not a person who doesn't really have intimacy with Christ. If you understand intimacy, you value yourself just because you're a Christian. That is your highest value. And you live in that light. You understand that? Intimacy with Christ means that you understand that my value in life is my value in Christ. I'm not important because I'm a Prince Charles. I'm not important because my father is this. I'm not important because Paul says, I throw all of that as garbage that I may find my value in who Christ has made me. So number three, your value must be the fact that in Christ I find my value. In Christ I find my importance. In Christ I find who I am. And that is a knowledge-based understanding of intimacy with Christ. So Christ is not for morning devotion. Christ is for mental devotion. Christ is not for singing. Christ is for priorities in life. Christ is not for tearing up and crying. Christ is for purpose-driven life. You understand that? That is where the abide with me come from. It's not abiding in me like I'm inside the church and I'm abiding. No. It's coming to how to prioritize your life, how to make decision based on who Christ is. You understand? How to evaluate and value and prioritize your life because of who Christ is. So number three, your value must come from Christ. Your values, the things you deem important, must come from Him. And you yourself, you should count your importance based on who you are in Christ. Hallelujah. And Paul says number four is to love Him. Amen. Is to love Him. And to love Him, Paul says that I may know Him and the fellowship of His suffering, being conformed to His His nature. So to love Jesus means that you are ready to go through things for Him. Amen. And for me, most people who have watched me grow up, they attribute my love for Jesus. And my wife would say, as for him, he loved Jesus. And people would testify because where I channel my energy, they can see that I do a lot of things that the average young man will not do for Jesus, right? They don't love Jesus that much the way I will portray. But I find it interesting because I don't intentionally set off to love Jesus. You know, maybe the grace that God has given, because with the things I do for God, I personally don't, it comes easy to me. Doing things for God, sacrificing for God, when it comes to things of God, going through all the pain and all of that for God is something that I don't struggle to do. But Paul says that it is part of the abiding with Him. It's part of abiding with Christ when you set yourself to go through the pain, to go through the problem, and to go through the suffering that you can go through. Pretty much, you love Jesus means you can inconvenience yourself for His cause. And one of the things that is important is to understand the cause of Christ. And you won't even know what Christ is about on earth if you don't know His assignment. So, I hope I have not disappointed you, but intimacy with Christ is real life application. It is not a religious duty at all. Intimacy with Christ is when your entire life is centered on the finished work of Christ and the knowledge thereof, and therefore your behavior and your attitude through life displays that you are intimate with Him. In other words, you are walking like you are intimate with Him. And so understanding the same way when it comes to intimacy with your partner, you behave like you are Mrs. You behave like you are Mr. So in the same way, when you are intimate with Christ, you behave every day like you are intimate with Him. So loving Jesus Christ means inconveniencing your schedule, inconveniencing your life so that Jesus will be glorified. Loving Jesus means that you are ready to go through suffering. Paul, example, he says that I may have fellowship of His suffering. Paul, to serve God is suffering. To serve Christ, His cause, to know what He wants and to do it is full of pain. And so when you don't love Him, you will not do it. Obeying God's word is inconvenient. Forgiving people, letting things go, serving, all of the instructions that are given. Jesus said, if you love me, obey my commandments. He didn't say, if you love me, worship me. He didn't even say that, right? If you love me, worship me. He says, the Father seeketh such worship. But He says, if you love me, obey my commandments. And some of the commandments of Jesus Christ, they are very, very difficult. You have to sacrifice and sacrifice and sacrifice to do it. But the point is, when it comes to Christ, if you are abiding with Him, it means, and even in the verse I talked about abiding in Him, He goes on to say that if you obey what my Father tells me, then you are continually going to be my disciples, and then you will live in me, and whatever you ask, you receive. So point number four is love Him and go through things because of Him. Suffer, you know, some people cannot suffer for Jesus Christ. Some people cannot suffer for Jesus Christ a bit. They can't inconvenience themselves. There are people, they can't walk 2 miles to go see Jesus. They can't go through the winter to serve Jesus. When it rains too hard, they won't go to church. When it snows, they will not go to church. It's like they want to serve God comfortably. And the Paul says, if you are going to be intimate with him, you can't serve him on a convenient basis. You have to serve him through sacrifice. You understand? And lastly, Paul says now, don't you do all your work because of heaven. He emphatically says that now, some people are living this life and they call themselves Christians, but all they care about is life only on this earth. You cannot be intimate with Jesus if you only care about life on this earth. And he says that you have to care about the life that is to come. So these are not religious points. These are practical ways you begin to live your Monday through Friday that shows that you are abiding in him. So I didn't come tell you that to abide in Christ, wake up at 4:30. That is religious. It doesn't make a difference if your life is not exemplifying what I'm saying. So when you are pursuing Christ, use this as a system. So anybody that's abiding in Christ, serve God with a good attitude. Anybody that is abiding in Christ has a good knowledge about the work of Christ. Today, if you call even some pastors, they don't even know the ministry of Jesus Christ. Because everything we teach is very, very shallow. To be intimate with Christ, you have to let your life be determined by who you are in Christ. And some people do have no idea who they are in Christ. And to know who you are in Christ, you have to sit down and be taught. And to know who you are in Christ, and to be intimate with Christ, you have to love Christ through the things you are willing to go through for him. The inconveniences, the sacrifices, the things that makes you uncomfortable. And still, you pursue the cause of Christ. And also, to be intimate with Christ means that your everyday life is shaped by your understanding that I'm not living for this earth alone. It says, for these people, their appetite is their belly, and for them, they only think about this life alone. If you are only thinking about this life alone, you cannot be intimate with Christ. So this is important. The whole book of Philippians, the whole book of Philippians chapter 3 will lay down all of this. There were more that he talked about, but I picked this four. And to recap, to be intimate with Christ, the first key is that you must serve Jesus Christ with a good attitude. When it comes to things of God, you must always approach it with joy. Not grumbling, not murmuring, not complaining, not whining, none of that. You have to serve. If you love the boy, you'll be happy when you're around him. So when you are serving the things of Christ, you always have to be joyful in Christ. You cannot be complaining in Christ. You have to always be joyful. Joy must be the way you serve God. And number two, you have to serve God and also understand that I have to invest in knowing the things of God. If you find a Bible teacher that can teach you, you have to invest and know, what does it mean to be propitiation? What does it mean to be atoned? What is the symbol? So you have to understand the doctrinal truth that guides your life. That is what intimacy with Christ is about. You must know doctrines, you must know biblical truth. You must know all the things that the believer must know to safeguard your life. Number three, you must put your value in Christ. In other words, it's not because you are a Ashanti man. It's not because you are from America. It's not because you are pretty. It's not because you finished college. It's none of that nonsense. Your value is because you are a Christian and born, and you are ready to throw everything away because being a Christian is more important to you than being a mother. Being a Christian is more important to you than being a wife. Being a Christian is more important to you than being anything else, because you find your value and your purpose in who you are in Christ. And you pursue that. What it means to be a Christian woman. What does it mean to be a Christian? That is where you are abiding in him. And number four, you love him because you are willing to sacrifice for him. You are willing to inconvenience yourself for him. You are willing to do certain things that your flesh wants to sleep on. You serve God whether rain or shine. That is abiding with him. And then lastly, you do things for God. You do your calling. You do your ministry. If you don't have a ministry that is kingdom oriented, if you're not doing anything for the kingdom of God and the life to come, then you cannot be intimate with Jesus Christ. So intimacy with Jesus Christ is not a religious terminology. It's not a prayer and fasting. It's not. Those things are supposed to feed you the strength you need to be intimate with Christ. Do you understand that? What is fascinating is that when the Bible talks about abide in me and you bear fruit, these are the things he's saying. These are the fruits of intimacy. And so I want you to focus on that, because some people are just abiding, sucking the power, but they don't know what to do with it. So these are the fruits that comes out of your life when you are intimacy with Christ. Amen. So I just wanted to show you that pursue that, know the markings, know the benchmarks that exemplify the fact that you are indeed truly a person that is intimate with Christ. Let's pray. We need your help, Jesus, to be intimate with you. Help us to pursue you, to love you, and to know you more. In Jesus' name, amen.